Welcome everyone to episode 47, Astroparticle Experiments to Improve the Biological Risk Assessment of Exposure to Ionizing Radiation in the Exploratory Space Missions. We have some very eminent persons in the field of space science today. Please welcome Dr. Alessandro Bartolini, who is a senior applied researcher at the Roma Sapienza Department of Italian Institute of Nuclear Physics, INFN, and a user of Associate at CERN. Please also welcome our second speaker, Dr. Mercedes Panicia. She's tuning in from Geneva today. She's a senior research associate at the University of Geneva. Her research focuses on cosmic ray measurements in space and development of spawn detectors. And today's moderator is Dr. Lidia Strigari. She's the head of medical physics department at the IRCCS University Hospital of Bologna, Italy. Our session today mainly focuses on the alpha magnetic spectrometer on the International Space Station, its construction, integration, launch, and specifications. In today's session, we also explore space radiation, the new era of exploration, human spaceflight stressors, and delve into the intricacies of space astroparticle experiments. So I hope you enjoy the time with us today on astroparticle experiments and space radiobiology. Dr. Lidia, the floor is all yours. So Lidia, let me just briefly introduce Dr. Lidia. As mentioned, she's the head of the medical physics department at the Hospital of Bologna in Italy. She obtained a master's degree in theoretical physics from the University La Calabria, and later the specialization medical physics and a PhD in advanced technology in biomedicine from the University of Rome. She has been a member of several international committees of European Association of Nuclear Medicine and International Commission on Radiation Units and Measurements, a principal investigator of several projects receiving funds by national and international research agencies, AIRC, NATO. Her research focus on medical physics, including radiobiological model development.
Thank you, Jan, for your kindly introduction. It's a pleasure to join you and our speaker today, and everyone we are with us in this afternoon or morning around the world. I'm honored to be a moderator and to introduce this session titled Astroparticle Experiment for Improving the Biological Risk Assessment of Exposure to Ionizing Radiation in Exploratory Space Mission. We have two fantastic speakers today, Alessandro and Mercedes, and it's going to be an exciting show. So I would like to introduce Alessandro Bartoloni background. Alessandro, after the master's degree in electronic engineering, joined the Italian Institute of Nuclear Physics, working in the Rome division on development of supercomputers and theoretical physics numerical simulation. Later, as a user of associated at the European Organization of Nuclear Research, better known as CERN, Alessandro participated to the construction of CMS detector that in 2012 was one of the experiments that observed and predicted the famous Big X boson. For several years, Alessandro was a lecturer on computer science at the Faculty of Engineering at the Sapienza University in Rome, Italy. And for more than 20 years, Alessandro was in the Alpha Magnetic Spectrometer Collaboration, AMS, representing the state-of-the-art particle physics detector designed to operate as an international module on International Space Station. His principal field of interest are cosmic rays, particle, and space radiation biology science. So Alessandro has a real wide background and a lot of share with us today. So without further delay, it is a pleasure to introduce Alessandro. Alessandro, the floor is yours.
Thanks, Lydia, for the introduction, and thanks also the Space for Women mission control team that gives me this opportunity to talk about the astroparticle experiments for space radiobiology. And about this, this is me in the control room of the Alpha Magnetic Spectrometer. This is one of the astroparticle experiments on board the International Space Station. I will skip the details about myself because Lydia did it enough. Well, I would like to spend a few words about the Italian National Institute for Nuclear Physics that I joined from the very beginning to do my master's degree thesis a lot of years ago. And this is still my main institute I work for. The institute was founded exactly 70 years ago in 1951 to continue and foster the prestigious tradition in the nuclear physics research that Enrico Fermi done 20 years before in Roma, and the famous school he created named I Ragazzi di Via Panisperna. 70 years later, the institute is now a reality, well established all over the Italian territory with more than 20 divisions. I work in the Roma 1 divisions. There are also 4 national laboratories, in particular the one in the center of Italy under the Gran Sasso Mountains. It's one of the biggest underground laboratories for physics research. The research lines are essentially mostly on nuclear physics and, of course, astroparticle physics. And in summary, the NFN is a community of over 6,000 people, if we take into account not only the staff, but also the research associate from many institutes and universities. Another strong point of the institute is its international DNA. That means that since the very beginning, it was fostered the collaboration with the most important laboratories in the world. Of course, CERN is one of that, and Fermi Lab also is another one, but this is a characteristic of our research institute. Okay, let's pass to the today's topics. It's about space radiation. That is a fascinating field, and above all, is an interdisciplinary field, because to fully understand the relationship between ionizing radiation and biology, and to solve the problem in this field, the researcher incorporates fundamentals of biology, physics, astrophysics, planetary science, and engineering. Today, we will see the possible connection between the astroparticle physics, that is the study of the astrophysical object and its phenomenology, like, for example, the supernova stars, or the blazar, or the black holes, and another field that is radiobiology, that is the study of the effect of the ionizing radiation on living matters. This in the constant, context of a new arising, not discipline, but activities, that is human space exploration, that is a step-by-step process that we will see in the future, the man coming back to the moon and then maybe to Mars. And this is what is planned by all the agencies. In this slide, it's possible to see the schedule, in particular the global exploration roadmap, lunar surface exploration scenario, updated last year by the International Space Exploration Coordination Group. This is a forum set up by the main 14 space agencies. And this is forecast a human landing system for this decade, and the coming back of the man with also the possibility to have some surface habitation. And after the 2030, it will be also the same forecast for Mars. Okay, just to say something about ionizing radiation. Every day we are receiving ionizing radiation when we live on the Earth, but the cosmic radiation is not a problem because we are very well protected by the magnetosphere, that is the magnetic field that is produced by the Earth, and it extends for thousands of kilometers and protect us from the cosmic radiation, the stop it or deflecting it. And another point is the atmosphere, because the Earth atmosphere is equivalent to a sort of shielding, like a water shielding 1 meter thick, that protects us, because when the cosmic ray or the cosmic particle interact with the atmosphere molecule, they will break into lighter particle and release most of its energy. So when they arrive on the surface, they are completely less dangerous than before they interact with the atmosphere. The natural background, so it depends very, is not so high, it depends from the cosmic ray for less than 10%. When we go to the space, the problem is completely different, because the human space activities must go with the high radiation environment water space that is composed essentially by three main components: the galactic cosmic rays coming from the astrophysical object like the supernova, that is composed by elementary particles like electrons or protons, but also from heavier particles like helium nuclei up to iron nuclei, and there are a sort of constant presence in the space. And then there is another component that are the solar energetic particles. This is not a constant component. It will depend strongly from the activity of the sun that generate some phenomena named solar flare or solar mass ejection that reach the Earth and the space near the Earth. Third component are the particles that are trapped in the Earth magnetic field, because the magnetic field creates some belts that are named the Van Allen belts, and the particle coming from the outer space will be trapped, so can be dangerous. This position, of course, is directed for the astronauts, where, for example, they perform an extravehicular activity, but also there is some danger when they are inside the Starship or the International Space Station, protected in principle by a shielding, because this particle coming from the outside interacting with the molecules, the atoms of the shielding, could produce secondary particle that could be also dangerous. So in this context, the human exploration of the space could reserve some problems, because the expected doses, that to say the quantity of radiation that is absorbed by humans, will be hundreds of times higher than on the Earth. This is very known from the beginning. This is the case of the first space mission, the Apollo space mission. In fact, there is in literature the event of the solar flare of 4 August 1972 that was monitored and registered from the Pioneer, NASA Pioneer probe, and we see that in that day there was an emission of protons very high that could be in principle of danger for humans exposed to that. And just to the history, there was just in the middle between the last two Apollo missions, the 16 and the 17 Apollo missions. So the problem was clear. So from the very beginning, the astronauts have some instruments, some dosimeter that allows to monitor the radiation dose that they kept. And this was for all these showed in this table for the Apollo missions, but this was done also for all the space mission that follows. And for this reason that there is all an activity to fix the limit that could be effectively absorbed by the astronauts. Each space agency fixes the maximum limit for each space mission. For example, this is an evaluation for missions that should be done in the low Earth orbit, for example, astronauts going into the International Space Station. So the process is that for human spaceflight to identify all the possible hazards for the exposition in space of astronauts that is not related only to radiation, but also, for example, to altered gravity or problems due to the isolation confined filament and so on. Then using the evidence, that is the data that are collected or from the astronaut or from other application of the same type, do the evaluation of the risk for the human generally or for single organs of the humans. The final target of the activity to fix the standards and also to plan and adapt for each space mission the necessary prevention, mitigation and countermeasures. In this context, instead talking about astrophysical astroparticle, in the last 2 decades there was numerous activity about space mission tailor-made to measure the cosmic ray, to detect energy particles, in this case to solve fundamental open physics problem. This is an exhaustive list of this type of mission, cosmic ray space mission, that flown in the last 2 decades. Some are still operating, for example, the Alpha Magnetic Spectrometer missions that we'll see will be the topic on the next talk. And the concept of this kind of missions is the same. Each detector, each experiment is an ensemble of instruments, each one designed to capture and measure the cosmic ray particles and its characteristics. For example, in this table related to the PAMELA experiment, you will see all the list of the particle that is able to detect and the kinetic energy range which is able to operate and do the measurement. This is particularly important because the biological effect of the ionizing radiation is strictly correlated to the mass of the particle and to the release of the kinetic energy of the particle inside the body cells. So, what happens using in a detector in an experiment when a particle flows through the detector, it leaves a signature in each instrument, and scientists doing the analysis of the data collected is able to reconstruct the type of the particles and the kinetic energy associated with it. Another important characteristic of this kind of experiment, they last for years in space, orbiting usually around the Earth, or installed on satellite, attached to satellite, or installed on the International Space Station, and so give us the possibility to measure this kind of cosmic radiation for a long time, and also see, appreciate the variation in time. These are the particles that are, for example, generated in the galactic cosmic ray by a supernova explosion, but they are essentially the same that could be of danger for the astronaut that will go outside the low Earth orbit, for example, on the Moon or toward Mars. So this is a typical example of the results in which for each particle there will be a measure of the presence of the particle and for each energy, how much kinetic energy, how much this particle is present, and also a possibility to see how these fluxes of particles have a variation during the time. So the cosmic ray data taken by this type of experiment contains information crucial for research in different fields. Of course, fundamental physics open problems, that is the primary aim for which this mission are tailored, but also they could be used to investigate the property of the sun, solar physics, and to improve the safety and healthy human space exploration. Also, there is a possibility to connect this kind of study results of data with the use that energy radiation have on the Earth, for example, in medicine. And this is why there is this strong collaboration with the Policlinico of Sant'Orsola in Bologna. Talking about radiobiology, this is a very complex problem because radiobiology. In a sense, are phenomena that going from micro to macro, because the particle interact with the DNA, causing break in the double helix of the DNA that could be more or less dangerous, single double. But from micro, they in a sense have an effect on a macro scale on the cells, generating the cells death, or even on the organs. Of the humans, of the human people. Of course, also another problem is that this kind of effects last from picoseconds just after the interaction of the particle with the cells, and they can we can see the effect only several years later, also in the generation after the one, because they can produce some mutation in the cells. From what regards the space, the only problem that distinguish from the usual radiobiology is that the particles that we are exposed are particles that are not present naturally in the Earth. And they could, since the damage is correlated to the mass, of course, this is the damage that in Earth we cannot observe naturally. You see, for example, here that an atom of hydrogen that is very light could have less dangerous than, for example, an atom of iron that is one of the more massive present in space. So this is the process to evaluate the risk assessment for the possible health hazard for an Explorer space mission is a very complex process that should take in account the different characteristic of the space radiation of the human biology. And in this context, the experiment, the cosmic ray mission tailored to measure the cosmic ray could be very useful. This is why in the group, MS group in Roma, there is this collaboration with the Politecnico Sant'Orsola in Bologna, in which we try to use the data coming from the MS detector to this kind of investigation. I finished my keynote, just one slide, because I would like to conclude with something that is related to this kind of initiative, that is the initiative that for me is also a memory of the good day in which I witnessed the taking of this photo on the left. It was in 2017 at the Italian Physics Society, the annual conference that the society organized. And there is a presence of women working in physics. So this initiative was to raise awareness of the importance of making visible the many women already work in the fields of physics, and to encourage the spread of female models in regard to scientific fields. I think that is exactly one of the motivations of the Space for Women initiative. In particular, the photo was a sort of replica of the one most famous photos that was done 90 years before in another conference. It was the most important conference on physics of the last century in Slovenia, Brussels. Of course, you can recognize a lot of very important physicists, in particular Albert Einstein, but the point of the initiative was that at that time, in that photo, there was 29 persons, 28 men, and just one woman. And so, to do this photo with 28 women and one man was just to signify that something has changed in the next 19 years. So, thanks for the attention, and I finish my presentation.
Thank you very much, Alessandro, for sharing with us this comprehensive overview on space radiation detectors, radiation biology. Your talk was really insightful. Now, I'd like to introduce Mercedes Paniccia, Brown, and Mercedes, after the Master's degree in Physics at the Sapienza University of Rome, Italy, obtained a PhD at the Geneva University with a thesis on search of time-dependent filtration in cosmic ray flux with AMS detector and construction of AMS-2 silicon tracker. She won a fellowship at the Frascati National Lab at the Italian Institute of Nuclear Physics. And thereafter, she obtained a postdoc position at the Laboratoire de la Science de Physique de Particules in France, working on the calibration commission on AMS-2 electromagnetic calorimeter and detector data analysis. Several years after, she became a senior researcher associate at the University of Geneva, working on AMS 0-2 operation that analysis, development of the polar detector, teaching C++ and MACD open online courses. And thereafter, she became a senior associated researcher and a team leader participating to the measurements on heavy nuclei fluxes and isotopic composition of light nuclei with ANS02. Currently, she's a deputy project manager and coordinator of the magnet construction and outreach and communication on development of the fan detector for deep space exploration. So without further delay, I will thanks again Mercedes Paniccia for joining us and delivering the next talk on Alpha Magnetic Spectrometer on the International Space Station. Please, Mercedes, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Lydia, for the introduction. So here you see the International Space Station. This is a picture taken from the Space Shuttle on one of the latest flights. And the AMS is right here, installed on the main truss of the International Space Station. This is a picture, a close picture of the Alpha Magnetic Spectrometer. It's a quite big detector. It measures about 5 meters times 4 times 3 meters. But it's still a small detector compared to those we use at accelerators. So the purpose of EMS is to measure cosmic rays, so particles, charged particles that comes from the outer space before they enter in the atmosphere, so before they interact with the atmosphere itself and they break up in other particles. In this way, we can easily identify the type of the particle. As Alessandro explained before, in cosmic rays we have all kinds of particles, from the so-called light elementary particles like electrons and their antiparticle called positrons, and then all sorts of nuclei, from hydrogen nuclei that are protons, up to very heavy nuclei like iron and even beyond. And plus we have a tiny amounts of antiprotons, which is the antiparticle of the proton, and of photons and neutrinos. These are neutral particles that we cannot detect with AMS. AMS has been installed on the International Space Station in 2011, so this year in May 16 will be 10 years since the launch of AMS to the space station. And we plan to operate AMS until the end of the ISS lifetime operation, so which has now been funded up to 2028 and will be probably expanded up to 2030. So we have still about other 10 years for data taking of AMS. AMS is a space version of a precision detector as those we use at accelerators like at CERN. Indeed, the community, the international collaboration who built the detector was previously working on detecting particles at accelerators. This is a schematic of the detector, which comprend several subsystems. Here in the top, the so-called TRD, which serves to identify light from heavy particles. And here you can see a different type of signal that we see. So an electron that is a light particle deposits a lot of signals in this subsystem, while a proton or nuclei will leave less signals. And this way we can distinguish them. Then we have a time of flight, which is these two layers here. These are also the redundant measurements of the velocity of the particle that tell us the direction, the incoming direction of the particle, whether it's coming from top to bottom or the other way around. Then the heart of the detector is a permanent magnet here. We inserted several silicon tracking detectors. These are detectors that can detect the position where the particle has passed with a precision at the level of tens of microns. We have an additional layer here and another one here. And with this detector, we measure the bending of charged particle inside the magnetic fields generated by the magnet. And this allows us to distinguish particles from antiparticles, which have opposite electrical charge. And this is very important to search for signals of antimatter in space. Indeed, at the Big Bang, the standard model of the theory that is the basis of fundamental physics tell us that the same amount of equal amount of matter antimatter should have been created, but today all the things and even us are made only by the matter part. So what is the counterpart, the antimatter? We don't observe stars made of antimatter. So with AMS, we can search for antinuclei that could be relics of the Big Bang. And then in addition, being able to measure antiparticles is important to measure the positrons, so the antiparticle of the electrons and the antiparticle of the protons, to search for the still elusive dark matter. Indeed, if dark matter is made of particles, this will annihilate or decay, will produce pairs of particles and antiparticles. So it's important to be able to detect both. Then at the bottom of the detector, we have another system called REACH. This is a detector that measures the velocity of the particle at a per mil precision. And the signal appears like a ring. And the more the particle is heavy, the more the ring will be illuminated. Then at the end of the detector, there is an electromagnetic calorimeter. This measure will precise, very precisely, the energy of light particle, like the electrons and the positrons, that allow us to distinguish between, again, light and heavy particles. This is particularly important because the signal of dark matter will be detectable only on particles that are quite rare in cosmic rays. So those particles that are created as secondaries, so by collision of cosmic rays, those that are produced at stars, with the interstellar medium while they propagate through the galaxy. So positrons and antiprotons are among these so-called secondary cosmic rays that are very rare. So since the signal expected from dark matter annihilation of dark matter particles are expected to be tiny because of other constraints of cosmological observation, so it's only in these rare particles that we will be able to distinguish anomalies that could be the signal of a dark matter particle. And then here you see a measurement of all the nuclei. So this is the charge measured by one of the subsystems, the TOF, and from the tracker and this other side. And as you can see, we measure protons, so hydrogen nuclei, up to nuclei like nickel, which has charges 28, so 28 times heavier than hydrogen nuclei. Then, as I mentioned before, AMS was built by an international collaboration. We have institutes from North America, Central America, Europe, also Asia. And as Alessandro mentioned before, in Italy, the main institute contributing was the Institute of National Nuclear Physics, INFN, and Alessandro was leading the group in Rome now. And nowadays, I am in the group, in the Swiss group, the group at the University of Geneva. And the University of Geneva has been one of the founding members of the AMS collaboration. When I joined the group was back in 2003. I was a PhD student and we had the responsibility of assembling the silicon tracker. So this is the system that is inside the magnet. And this is a picture in 2007 when we had just finished the assembly of the subdetector. And so you can see me and my colleague and another PhD student. We were all wearing white, and all the other people are technicians and professors. Then in 2010, we decided to rearrange the detector just before the launch. And this is me again in the Geneva clean room. with one of these layers of silicon trackers. So the golden modules that you see here are detecting modules, and the black is just the supporting structure. Then we send the detector at CERN, and there we had a large assembly to assemble all the subsystems I have shown to you before together. So this is a picture of the tracker inserted inside the magnet, for instance. Then we had, this is the AMS detector fully assembled and put in a horizontal position to test it and calibrate it with the particles beams at CERN accelerators. Soon after, we brought AMS to the NASA Kennedy Space Center in Florida to prepare it for the launch to the International Space Station. So this is me in one of the hall of Kennedy Space Center, and this is a picture of the French-speaking part of the AMS collaboration at the time. So the Annecy in France group, she was the team leader of the French group at the time. I was working with the French, and these are people from Geneva at the time, part of the group, with the principal investigator of the the AMS experiment, Nobel laureate Professor Samuel Tink. And in the back you can see the space shuttle. And this is a broader picture with more of collaboration members for which were present at the time in Florida, including the team from NASA who was helping to prepare AMS for the launch. We launched AMS in May 2011. This is a picture of the launch at the NASA Kennedy Space Center. And a few days after, we started taking data. So the station is orbiting at an altitude of 400 kilometers around the Earth. And every 1 hour and a half, 92 minutes, it makes a complete turn around the Earth. And this is a picture of me in July 2011 at NASA Johnson Space Center in Houston, from where we were operating the AMS for the first month after launch. Then now we operate AMS from our main Payload Operation Control Center, which is located at CERN in Geneva. This is a picture. So we control the detector. So the detector has an onboard computers, and we monitor the data taking and the health and status of the detector from the AMS Payload Operation Control Center in Geneva. The communication is done through the NASA Marshall Space Flight Center, to the internet. From there, they send signals to the antennas in NASA White Sands sites in New Mexico. The signals are sent to the TDRS data relay system satellites and collected by antennas on the space station. We also have a laptop on board the space station, which serves if there are some special manipulation to be done directly from space, but this is happens very rare. And if needed, the astronauts can operate AMS under our directions. So then to download the data, we do the other way back, so from the satellites to White Sands, NASA, and back to CERN. So far we have collected more than 107 billion cosmic ray events, and we expect to double these statistics at the end of the operation of AMS in 2030. This is a very huge statistics in cosmic rays. And so we are now devoted in monitoring the detector at CERN, and most of the time what we do is to work on the data analysis. And I'm leading now the Geneva group. You see some of the students that are working with me. I have now 3 PhD students and a postdoc that is visiting from Shandong Institute of Advanced Technology, and plus from before the pandemic, I was hosting in the summer students from other institutes to spend 3 months working with us. So with AMS, we have now published very interesting results on the fluxes of electrons and positrons, so which are, as I say, particles and antiparticles counterpart, but also on protons and antiprotons. We have now measured nuclei up to silicon, so we are in the middle of the periodic table, let's say, that we can measure. We can do isotopic composition, so we can distinguish the different kind of masses between the light nuclei, in this case helium, and also we can measure very precisely the fluxes, the daily fluxes of the most abundant particles in cosmic rays, like protons and helium nuclei. As you see here, these are the fluxes of protons as function of time, the times run in circles, and the change of the fluxes is connected to the variability, the variation of the solar activity. So the Sun cycle has 11 years periodicity, so we expect that in 10 years this circle will close back. And then the different colors give you the fluxes, the intensity of particles changes as function of the particle energies. So the more more energetic particles do not feel the effect from the sun activity. And in the bottom is a similar plot, but for helium nuclei, which has been heavier particles. And then to go back to the topic of today, with this kind of fine measurements, we can also investigate the measurement around in near Earth, so in orbit at the space station. So the Earth is as a magnetic field itself, and so what we observe, we have a highest radiation at the close to the magnetic poles and the South Atlantic anomaly here, which is the bottom of the inner Van Allen belt, where there are trapped particles by the Earth magnetosphere. So we have done some investigation on this as well, and we have found that there are different, for instance, if you look at helium nuclei, there exist two different nuclei with different masses, helium-3, that is lighter, and helium-4, which is heavier. And we found that the composition of these two isotopes are found in different places. For instance, around the equator, there is only the lightest one. And as I told you, we can measure nuclei from hydrogen nuclei up to nickel. So, and here we did a measurement of the fluxes of heavy nuclei, so from helium up to zinc. What we found is that there are no radiation found in the South Atlantic anomaly. We still see the galactic one coming from the polar region. And as a comparison, so protons are seen trapped around the Earth, while iron is only seen coming from the outside. And this concludes my presentation.
Thank you very much, Mercedes, for sharing with us your exciting and inspiring experience within the IMS collaboration. And I think that the audience really enjoyed your talk and the talk of Alessandro. I will ask to Jan if you have the time for questions or not.
Yes, we have a question for Dr. Mercedes. Has the AMS discovered any new variation in the proton fluxes in the Van Allen belts and electrons in the outer radiation belt?
So as I showed before, with the AMS we have at an altitude of 400 kilometer altitude from the Earth. So we are not in the region. The Van Allen belts are much higher. The only part of the Van Allen belts we see is in this South Atlantic anomaly, which is the fact that we can see this is because the Earth magnetic field is not centered with the geometric geographical center of the planet. And so here the inner Van Allen belt comes much down at this few hundreds kilometer altitude. And so what we can see with the AMS is only this part. And what we observed that there are This was already known by previous measurement that is mostly done by light particles, electrons and protons, but we have also tested that there are no heavy particles, because these trapped particles, by turning around all the time in these belts, interacts, so the heavy ones from MENS in the lightest one.
Thank you, Dr. Messiris. There's a question for Dr. Alessandro. How severe is the ionizing radiation damage if it causes a DNA double-strand break?
Okay. Yes, the DSB, the double-strand break, is one of the possible damages produced by ionizing radiation. And in general, when there is this type of break, it is triggered a DNA repair mechanism. The point is that when just a single strand is broken, the other strand is used as a model by the cell repair mechanism, and so the possibility or the probability that the repair have a good end is very high. On the contrary, double strand break, there is no model to follow for the repair mechanism in the cells. And so this is very dangerous because there is a high probability that the cells will death. And also there is another maybe worse problem, that the repair could induce some mutation. So it's a sort of misrepair. The repair ends, but the cells is damaged, continue living with some mutation. This mutation, time to time, could have dangerous events for the person, or even transmit in the next generation.
Thank you. The next question is, Mercedes, how will the AMS help our understanding of the origins of the universe?
So one of the questions that is still unanswered about the origin of the universe is this asymmetry between matter and antimatter. According to the Big Bang theory, at the time we should have had the equal amount of matter and antimatter created. But nowadays, what we observe around us is only made by matter. It means that it's made of protons and electrons and neutrons, but not from. We never observe stars of objects made by any positrons with a nucleus made by antiprotons. This has been created in the lab at CERN, for instance, but it's not been observed in nature. With AMS, we can search for antinuclei, and in particular for the lightest one, like antihelium. And if we see this kind of particles, if we confirm observation of this kind of particles, they could come, they could be a relics from the Big Bang. And this will help then the theorists to understand how much antimatter is left around, or if there is no antimatter, then they should try a new model or to refine, to justify the current observations.
Thank you, Dr. Mercedes. The next one is for Alessandro. What are the advancements in understanding the radiation dosimetry levels and protection methods for manned space flights?
The major advances in understanding the radiation dosimetry levels and protection methods for manned space flights, consists of four principal steps. So the first is the needed to measure and characterize the spectra of cosmic rays. This is done using the dosimeter that is wear by the astronauts, or using this experiment like AMS. The second is to implement and create a numerical simulation on the interaction particle with living matters. That means really understand for each type of particles, that is usually says as named radiation quality, which is the damage that is produced interacting with the living matter. Then the third point is to study the biological effects of the astronauts, so using the existing space mission to really try to correlate the dose of ionizing radiation absorbed during the mission and the biological effects on the astronauts. Furthermore, the research could do is to develop a ground experiment using beams, like, for example, the one that are at CERN or in the hospital, to try to improve, to make some experiment, to try to improve the mathematical models that allow us to describe the biological effects as a function of the absorbed dose, because these mathematical models then can be used to predict what happens in new mission in function of the exposition scenario. And this also will be useful for a safe and healthy human space exploration in the future.
Thank you, Alessandro. Marta asked, I think we have 8 more minutes. Marta asked, how are biological risk assessments changing, improving to better predict exposure to radiation?
Okay, yes, there is a lot to do in that sense, because up to now the space exploration was limited to few people, some, let me say, heroes in a sense. Less than 1,000 people so far have the opportunity to go to the space, and very few outside the protection of the magnetosphere, outside the low Earth orbit, in a sense only the Apollo mission astronauts. So with the new scenario in which a lot of people will go to the space, of course, the improvement with regard the possibility to include the correlation with the sex, correlation with the age, and above all, the past individual radio sensitivity, because all the agencies that work on this kind of subject reports that 5 to 15% of people have a particular radio sensitivity, so are particularly sensible to the ionizing radiation, more than the average. So all these aspects, of course, should be improved to better predict the space exploration. Above all, when we do not talk of exploration, but in a sense, in the future, also of colonization, because this is what on the long term is forecast by the agencies.
Thank you, Alessandro. Nayan asked, how have previous biological risk assessments contributed to potentially protecting humans from radiation future space missions?
Okay, so of course, the experience was very, very important in any field of research. In this case, using the experience from the previous missions, it was crucial to really identify the right design parameters, for example, for the Starship shielding or for the shielding on the station, like, for example, the International Space Station. Any new mission reports a lot of information. Any new astronauts, for example, going to the International Space Station reports in itself the very, very important information that could be used for the next generation, for the next crew, or for the next missions.
Thank you, Alessandro. When speaking of the collected billions of data points since the inception of the Alpha Magnetic Spectrometer, O2 to the ISS, how does a single data point make a difference?
So these under 7 billions are the particles. So every one is a particle that has passed through the detector and whose characteristics have been measured. So the particle has been identified. So because especially the nuclei are only 1% of the total radiation in cosmic particles, and are, for instance, if we speak in terms of biological hazards, they are more dangerous because they are more massive. then every single particle we can collect will improve the measurements of the intensity that we are performing. And so we will improve the knowledge of the how many of these kind of particles are emitted, created in the cosmos, but also more generally in the terms of understanding fundamental physics issues like cosmic ray particles properties, a detailed precision of the how the intensity evolves as function of the energy of the particles. This is important for us to understand all the mechanisms that are behind the sources of cosmic rays and the mechanisms that they suffer, how they are accelerated and what they happen to them while they propagate through the galaxy.
Thank you, Mercedes. The next question, collisions of dark matter produce additional positrons apart from those created by collisions of ordinary cosmic rays. How can we see this excess of positrons in the AMS data?
So this to disentangle signal that could possibly arise from dark matter, we have to rely on models, so models of cosmic rays that do the calculation of how many positrons are produced as secondaries by collision of the other cosmic rays with the interstellar matter. And so in this sense, as of today, we don't have still a comprehensive model that is able to explain all the observations that have been done, many by AMS. That's why it's important for us to measure all the single element, all the single nuclei, because putting together all the pieces of this puzzle, then we can arrive to a global picture, to a comprehensive model, and so be able to have a robust calculation of those positrons that will be produced by normally ordinary cosmic rays, and what is left as an excess on top of this background, let's say.
Thank you. How did changing the original cryogenic magnet with a permanent magnet change the outcomes of AMS-02?
So the change to the permanent magnet has made the operation of AMS easier and allow us also to have a long duration, because you must say that at the beginning, when AMS was designed, the idea was to run it for 5 years. So we are now running it since 10 years and it's going smoothly. We just had an upgrade of the cooling system at the beginning of 2019, the beginning of 2020. And so replacing the permanent magnet the cryogenic magnet with the permanent magnet has allowed us also to have this long mission duration, because the cryogenic one would require a reservoir of fluid to cool it down.
Thank you. Malak, you had a CERN-related question?
I have a lot of questions, and I hope another episode we speak about CERN experiments and the discovery how they could get our species evolved into the cosmos and other planets if they are related. And my question is how the Large Hadron Collider experiment could bring any addition to the existing experiments and research that we are making right now to be a multiplanetary species, means like to have settlement on other planets. Is there any correlation?
Yes, generally speaking, CERN, in my experience as a user since more than 20 years, time to time have developed a lot of innovative technology. Just to make an example, not directly correlated to the space quest, at the beginning of the 90s, I was the opportunity to use the first web browser. Because in a sense, the internet or the use of the web, as we know today, was developed at CERN to allow all the people that from all the part of the world to collaborate and do the data analysis of the experiments. That means that there is no direct connection with the space activity, but all the technologies that are developed at CERN, starting from the superconducting magnet, but also in the detector technology, the same particles that are present in the CERN experiment are in space. So this kind of technology could be in the innovative technology could be indirectly or crucial for the space exploration because, for example, in Moon Village could be used to do the monitoring in real time of the radiation and to say to the people living there, which is the moment in which a solar flare proton particles start arriving, so it's to be protected by this. So there is not the direct, but a lot of an indirect product of the work done at CERN, and of course from all the institutes that collaborate at CERN, because this is CERN is the one of the most important place for scientific collaboration, could be, let me say, crucial and in a sense very, very important for the space activities.
Thank you. If I may ask another question, and it's very important because actually a lot of discussions about the fear of a Large Hadron Collider and the experiments is done and the God's particle and all these kind of things in this like mainstream. Would you like to say something about that? To clarify a little bit to people it's an experiment and it's safe for the public and so on.
I just can say, always as a user since a long time, that one of the statements, the first statement of CERN is safety first. And this regards not only the workers, safety of the workers, but also safety, environment safety, a safety of all, people, stakeholders that could be involved in the CERN activities. This is a priority for CERN. It was, the first statement, safety first, and this means apply to all possible activities the dangers that could be generated. So this is what I can say.
Well, thank you everyone for your presence and participation today. Thank you, Dr. Mercedes, Dr. Lydia, and Dr. Alessandro for making this high-level show accessible for the general public. Thank you, everyone. We'd love to hear your feedback. I think it would make sense to have a second part of a CERN show, right? But for now, we'll welcome you next week for our second Space for Kids show, aged 12 till 16, I believe. So as soon as we log off, you'll be able to register there. Thank you much, everyone, and stay safe, everyone. And have a great weekend.